Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents If Your Adolescent Has Depression, an Essential Resource for Parents, by Dwight L. Evans, M.D., Moira A. Rynn, M.D., and Katherine Ellison. Narrated by Petrea Burchard. Publisher's Note: This audiobook contains references to material present in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. More than merely moody. Raising an adolescent is rarely a breeze. Your child's brain and body are changing profoundly and quickly. Fluctuating hormones spark emotional storms. It's all part of the bargain you didn't know you'd made when you first held that tiny infant in your arms. Most parents manage to navigate the ups and downs, trusting they won't last forever. Yet sometimes dramatic changes in moods are wake-up calls to a more serious problem, namely clinical depression, otherwise known as major depressive disorder. Depression can be mild or severe. Many kids learn to manage it on their own. Yet millions of parents have been caught off guard by a non-negotiable signal that they need to step in. If you've started listening to this book, you may recognize the shock these parents felt when they first saw that red flag.
"Jenny was 13 when I brought her in for a regular checkup with her pediatrician," says her father, Miles. "The doctor called me in to show me all the scars on her arm, where she had been cutting herself with a razor."
Maybe your child has put you on notice more subtly. Perhaps your son recently quit his after-school baseball team and has been sleeping later than usual. Or your formerly sunny daughter has been pleading to stay home from school, complaining of mysterious aches and pains. Young people have lots of good reasons to be moody these days, apart from their changing biochemistry. Climate change, income inequality, increasing competition for jobs, and a lot of disturbing, nonstop content on social media all likely help explain some of the recent uptick in depression and anxiety in adolescents. In a mostly positive development, young people today are also more willing to talk about problems that used to be too shameful to reveal. In this book, however, we'll focus on how genes, trauma, and stress can help turn common worries into clinical-grade suffering that needs your prompt attention. This is the case when sorrow, hopelessness, or apathy lasts more than a couple of weeks, interfering with life at home, school, or work. Doctors who treat adolescents once believed they were immune to clinical depression. Only in recent decades has there been wide acceptance that children may suffer this illness. Indeed, we now know that depression often first appears during the adolescent and young adult years, and sometimes even before puberty. In adolescents, just as in adults, it can be a serious, long-lasting, and recurring problem. The company you keep. As someone who loves someone who is clinically depressed, you may already know you're not alone. Depression was already one of the most common mental illnesses worldwide before the rates began to climb in recent years. The rise has been particularly sharp among those aged 12 to 17, a subset of adolescents defined by the World Health Organization as from 10 to 19. In 2017, 13% of U.S. youth aged 12 to 17, nearly 1 in 8, said they had experienced at least one major depressive episode in the past year, according to a Pew Research Center analysis. That was up from 8% in 2007. Then came the COVID-19 pandemic, with its traumas and social isolation. In its first 2 years, symptoms of anxiety and depression worldwide reportedly doubled. In one survey, 46% of U.S. parents said they'd noticed that their children's mental health had worsened. Mental health care professionals who treat young people reported a huge increase in demand. One psychiatrist called it an avalanche of severely depressed and anxious youth. Leading U.S. health groups have been sounding alarms. As of this writing, the American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, and the Children's Hospital Association have all declared a national emergency in youth mental health. These trends highlight a major reason why your job as a parent today is, frankly, harder than it has ever been. If your child is seriously depressed, the work may demand quite a lot of your time, money, if you have it, attention, smarts, and networking skills. Our intent with this book is to help ease that burden, supporting you so that you and your adolescent can thrive. As many a parent can tell you, your work can't start too soon. I wish I'd recognized depression for what it was, says Carol, a mother and fundraiser for a nonprofit organization. It's so easy to mistake it for social awkwardness or just being a loner. When my son was in high school, he started staying in his room a lot, with his door closed. I thought he was just studying hard. By the time I truly understood the problem, he had turned 18, and I didn't have as much influence. Life between the extremes. Like most physical illnesses, mental illness occurs on a continuum. On one end lies optimum mental health, allowing people to process thoughts and feelings in a way that help them succeed in school or at work, have fulfilling relationships with other people, and cope with change and adversity. On the other end lies illness, diminishing the capacity to function in any of these spheres. Most of us live near the healthy end of these two poles, with good days and bad days. Your task will be to help your child move closer to that healthier side, with many more good days than bad ones. There is no magic formula. No book can substitute for individual professional diagnosis and treatment. If you suspect your child is more than ordinarily moody, we urge you to have him or her evaluated by a qualified mental health professional as soon as possible. Still, it's worth understanding that no matter how much you're willing and able to work and pay, there is no such thing as magic. No fast-acting, surefire pill or therapeutic technique to treat a mood disorder. Nor is it certain that you'll find a Dr. Right to lead you and your child swiftly out of distress. Helping to lift a child's mood can take time, and you are dealing with a medical system that, by many accounts, is broken. Parents often feel frustrated as they absorb just how different psychiatry is from orthopedics or cardiovascular surgery. While mental illnesses often have physical symptoms, there is much more variation, subjectivity, and often controversy surrounding approaches to address them. Mental health treatments are often more complex and multi-layered than setting a bone or repairing a leaky valve, involving learned habits, environments, and thinking styles. To give your child the best chance of success, you'll need to educate yourself. A basic understanding of diagnoses and treatments will help you choose a specialist, know the right questions to ask, and understand the advice you get. Without wishing to scare you, we do want to emphasize the high stakes. Depressed adolescents are considerably more likely than others to intentionally injure themselves, including attempting suicide, a risk that has been tragically increasing. In recent years, suicide has become the second leading cause of death for this age group. The U.S. suicide rate for those aged 10 to 24 rose by more than 57% from 2007 to 2018. Up to nearly 11 youth per 100,000. And that was before COVID-19. Knowledge is power. The news may be grim, but remember, depression is a treatable illness. In the following sections, we'll empower you with lots of practical information and suggestions. Among other things, we'll tell you how to recognize depression, what treatments are available, how you can help prevent relapses and reduce the symptoms, how you can find a therapist, how you can help your child at home and at school, and what to do in an emergency. We'll give you the most up-to-date guidance on how to be a smart healthcare consumer, including information on the safety and side effects of common medications, how to figure out the right kind of medical insurance, and how to find financial support if you can't afford insurance. We'll describe the risks of consuming alcohol, recreational drugs, and social media, and suggest how to reduce stress at home. We'll also explain how to understand and establish an individualized education program at school, and how best to prepare your child for life after high school. Finally, we'll offer some language to speak openly about mental illness and health with your child,
as well as with anyone else in your world who may need to know what's going on. Throughout the book, you'll hear from credentialed experts and also from many ordinary parents throughout America, and a few of their children, who have walked this road before you and learned from their experiences. We found our brain trust through a variety of sources. Some parents were active on social media. Others were personal friends and acquaintances. Some were patients. Still others were authors who have written about their children's struggles. Some were interviewed while amid heartbreaking struggles. Others, with their children grown, were able to look back calmly on the choices that helped them endure. In several cases, we follow their stories all the way through the book. To protect their privacy in all but a few cases, we changed their names, but we use their quotes verbatim. The one question we asked all of them was, "What did you learn?" Reasons for hope. There are many reasons for worry, but we also have a lot of good news to share as you embark on this journey with your child. Many parents manage to find compassionate and effective help from professionals willing to go well beyond the call of duty. Some have even found insurance plan managers keen to ensure they're getting all the help they need. Another bright sign is the sharp decrease in recent years in misinformation and stigma surrounding mental illness. For centuries, people with severe depression or other mental illnesses were thought to be possessed by evil spirits. Exorcism and bloodletting were once among cutting-edge treatments. Even in recent decades, mental health experts wrongly cast blame for mental illnesses and behavioral disorders like autism and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, on bad parenting, and most often on bad mothering. Many people suffering depression resisted talking openly about their struggles out of a reasonable fear that they'd be blamed and ostracized. In the last several years, there's been a sea change, however, with many national campaigns against stigma, including Make It Okay and Bring Change to Mind. A thriving genre of movies, including Little Miss Sunshine, Girl Interrupted, and Inside Out. Podcasts, like The Hilarious World of Depression, and even musicals, including Dear Evan Hansen and Next to Normal, have contributed to this movement. A brave procession of famous people has meanwhile shared their stories of mental illness in memoir after memoir, and in interviews with traditional and social media. They include writers, musicians, actors, politicians, athletes, and royal family members who've opened up about what it's like to suffer and cope with depression. I slept all the time, because sleeping was basically better than offing myself. Olympic gymnast Simone Biles said of the depression she suffered after being sexually abused by former USA Gymnastics team doctor Larry Nassar. "I felt like I was behind a veil," TV producer Oprah Winfrey said of a depression that lasted 6 weeks. "I felt like what many people had described over the years on my show, and I could never imagine it. What's depression? Why don't you just pick yourself up?" I'm on a variety of medications that keep me on an even keel. Otherwise, I can swing rather dramatically and just the wheels can come off a little bit, said rock star Bruce Springsteen. None of this implies that stigma has vanished, but it's never been less of an obstacle, which makes your job much easier. And here is the best news of all. Adolescents' brains are changing and growing all the time, most often, believe it or not, for the better. Sometimes all a parent needs to do is keep showing love and maintain communication until the crises pass. Of course, it's still enormously demanding to be constantly worried about your child's safety while helping someone who may be, at least temporarily, incapable of showing much love in return. But as we hope to show you, there are lots of ways to lighten the load. Welcome to the journey. Some parents of children with depression describe their challenge as a spiritual journey, a helpful way to reframe all that stress and unpaid labor. As you embark, we hope to be your straight-talking companion and practical guide. We understand how much you may need a non-judgmental friend. This is an isolating experience because you do not feel you can share this with people, and it is isolating because when you do share it with others, they do not understand, says Maria, who sought help for her 14-year-old daughter, Lourdes, after she withdrew and lost interest in school. It's hard to find other parents of kids with a mental illness because who the hell wants to advertise it, writes Michigan Mom in an online essay. Oh, your kid is on the debate team? That's great. My son was nearly institutionalized for being suicidal, and I had to take away anything sharp, and his belts, from his room. Want to meet for coffee and chat about it? No, not likely. Like many other parents, Maria and Michigan Mom found solace through friendships with other mothers whose children were similarly struggling. We urge you to track down these online and in real life, IRL, friendships as well. It was such a comfort to know that I was not alone, that these moms get it, that I had a place to pour it all out to parents who had been there and survived, writes Michigan Mom. These parents are my lifeline and my heroes. There is comfort in numbers, even as the numbers are increasing. But the bottom line is that you can make a critical difference at this critical time in your child's life. And while from time to time you may feel frustrated, confused, or even overwhelmed, take heart. Our society is finally waking up to this crisis, and the prognosis for our youth is increasingly hopeful. The authors. This book has three co-authors. Co-author Dwight L. Evans, M.D., sadly passed away as this book was going to press. He was the Joseph and Madonna DiGiacomo Professor of Psychiatry and Professor of Psychiatry, Medicine, and Neuroscience at the Perelman School of Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania. He was chair of the Depression and Bipolar Commission of the Annenberg Adolescent Mental Health Initiative and past president of the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention and the American College of Psychiatrists. Co-author Moira A. Rynn, M.D., an expert in the treatment of mood and anxiety disorders across the lifespan, is chair of the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Duke University School of Medicine. Dr. Rynn has served as a principal investigator or co-principal investigator on numerous controlled adult and pediatric clinical trials involving medication and psychosocial treatments, and has led medication clinical trials in pediatric mood and anxiety disorders. Co-author Katherine Ellison is a Pulitzer Prize-winning former foreign correspondent, an author and co-author of 10 nonfiction books, who has specialized in reporting on mental health issues for the past 2 decades. Her articles on mental health and other topics have appeared in leading publications, including The New York Times, The Washington Post, Scientific American, and Knowable Magazine. We are grateful to veteran science writer Linda Wasmer Andrews for her contributions to the book's first edition in 2005, which was titled If Your Adolescent Has Depression or Bipolar Disorder. Katherine would additionally like to thank the psychiatrists Michelle Gouchereau, Kiki Chang, Jean Malofsky, and James Ellison, the psychologists Stephen Hinshaw and Arch Nabasu, and the education expert Patricia Howey for their consultations on the current edition. All of us are particularly indebted to the many parents of children with depression throughout the country who became our brain trust, contributing their hard-won wisdom. We deeply appreciate their generosity in speaking with us. No pharmaceutical funding was used in the development or marketing of this book. Dr. Moira Rynn serves as the chair of the Data Safety Monitoring Board for Experimental Compounds for Pediatric Behavioral Health Disorders for the following pharmaceutical companies, AbbVie, Inc. Katherine Ellison has nothing to disclose. One final note before we get started. Depression, the focus of this book, is one of two varieties of mood disorders, the other of which is bipolar disorder. In bipolar disorder, depressed periods alternate with the sometimes giddy highs known as mania. If you're seeking information on that illness, please see our companion book, If Your Adolescent Has Bipolar Disorder. Chapter 1. Understanding Depression. If you've never suffered from depression, the first thing to know is that it's more serious than sadness. The illness affects both the brain and the body with emotional, mental, behavioral, and physical consequences. A single episode of untreated depression can last up to 9 months, robbing a child of an entire school year. Major depressive disorder is clinically defined as a pervasive feeling of sorrow, hopelessness, or apathy that lasts more than a couple of weeks for a good part of each day, interferes with life at home, school, or work, and may not respond to changing circumstances. Some who have suffered depression would argue that even this description doesn't capture the pain. Depression is a wimp of a word for a howling darkness in the brain, the author William Styron wrote in his groundbreaking 1989 book, Darkness Visible, A Memoir of Madness. If I had to describe how depression made me feel in four words, I'd say, unwelcome in my mind, writes Ruby Walker in her self-published book, Advice I Ignored, Stories and Wisdom from a Formerly Depressed Teen. A few days before her 15th birthday, Walker had sunk so low that she stopped going to school for a full semester. Day in, day out, I was bullying myself, she writes. I was under constant attack. An illness almost like any other. Mood disorders, including depression, are in fundamental ways like any other illness. Hypertension affects the blood vessels. Asthma affects the lungs. Arthritis affects the joints. And mental illness affects the brain. Depression isn't due to bad character or lack of effort. You wouldn't urge a child with asthma to think positively the next time he or she has trouble breathing, or one with diabetes to hope for the best the next time his or her blood sugar levels shoot up. Instead, you would surely try to provide the best possible professional treatment while supporting your child at home. Plan on taking that same approach with your child's depression. At the same time, there are some striking differences between mood disorders and purely physical illnesses. For one thing, we unfortunately still know much less about what causes mood disorders, although we do have some good ideas. Another big difference is the absence of any objective measuring technique, like a blood test or brain scan, to diagnose illnesses of the brain. Instead, a mental health professional or physician must evaluate a person's symptoms with the help of checklists and criteria provided in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM, the regularly updated guide relied on by U.S. mental health professionals. The latest version of this manual is a revision of the fifth edition, the DSM-5, released in 2022. Adults and adolescents have similar symptoms with a few variations. Experts note that depressed children, particularly boys, may often appear to be more irritable than sad compared to their elders. Next, you'll hear the key criteria for major depressive disorder from the DSM-5. Diagnosing depression. Five or more of the following symptoms must be present nearly every day during the same 2-week period. Depressed or irritable mood for most of the day. Markedly diminished interest or pleasure in almost all activities for most of the day. Weight loss or weight gain, or increase or decrease in appetite. Or for children, failure to make normally expected weight gains. Insomnia or hypersomnia. Excessive sleeping. Fatigue or loss of energy. Feelings of inappropriate guilt or hopelessness. Indecisiveness or diminished ability to concentrate. Recurrent thoughts of death or suicide, a suicide attempt or specific plan to do so. Behavior that seems either overly keyed up or unnaturally slowed down. These symptoms must represent a marked change from the person's previous usual state, must impair functioning at home, work, or school, and cannot be due to the direct physiological effect of substance use or a medical condition. This list was adapted from the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 5th edition, text revision. Arlington, Virginia, American Psychiatric Association, 2022. A parent's input. When diagnosing an adult, a therapist will glean most, if not all, information from talking directly to the patient. With adolescents, however, parents, guardians, and sometimes also teachers are important sources of information. Parents know their children's life histories better than anyone else. Parental input is key as well, because the youth themselves may have trouble expressing their feelings, lack insight into them, or resist discussing them. Red flags. Depression doesn't usually appear full-blown overnight. Instead, it may start as anxiety or a mild case of the blues that worsens over time. Often, the transition to a genuine disorder is so gradual that parents miss the warning signs until there is a crisis. As with any other illness, however, the earlier depression is professionally diagnosed and treated, the sooner suffering can be relieved, and the better the long-term outcome may be. That's why you should become familiar with these not always subtle behaviors, some of which are also clinical symptoms. Increased irritability, crankiness, hostility, or anger. Decreased interest in friends and activities. Difficulty concentrating. A sudden drop in grades. Frequent absences from school. Complaints of tiredness, boredom, or vague aches and pains. Changes in sleep patterns, such as insomnia or oversleeping. Alcohol or substance use. Social withdrawal. Hypersensitivity to rejection or failure. Self-deprecating remarks. Thoughts that life is not worth living. Variations on a theme. No two people get depressed in the same way. A psychiatrist who diagnoses your child with depression may add a specifier that further describes what's going on. The list of these includes the following. Chronic, when symptoms of major depressive disorder last continuously for at least 2 years. Catatonic, when a depressed person's behavior seems either unnaturally slowed down or keyed up. This rare condition could include stupor, refusal to speak, purposeless overactivity, and peculiar mannerisms such as grimacing or mimicking another person's speech or movements. Melancholic, showing a near complete lack of interest or pleasure in almost all activities. The person's mood never brightens, even temporarily or when something good happens. Psychotic, when the depressed person suffers delusions, that is, beliefs out of touch with reality. This could include thinking other people can hear one's thoughts, or sensory perceptions of things that don't exist, such as disembodied voices. Atypical, more common than its name implies, especially in young people, this type of depression is diagnosed in people who can cheer up when something good happens before sinking back after it's over. Other symptoms may include significant weight gain, an increase in appetite, oversleeping, a weighed-down feeling in the arms or legs, and a long-running pattern of hypersensitivity to personal rejection. Seasonal, also known as seasonal affective disorder, or SAD. When symptoms of depression start and stop around the same time each year. Typically, they begin in fall or winter and subside in spring. The onset seems to be linked directly to the change of season, in particular, reduced exposure to sunlight in winter, rather than the start of school, as some parents might assume. Premenstrual. Similar to premenstrual syndrome, PMS, but more serious in nature, premenstrual dysphoric disorder, PMDD, causes severe irritability, depression, or anxiety in the week or two before the start of a period, with symptoms usually going away 2 or 3 days afterward. These are all varieties of major depressive disorder. There are also some related illnesses, which will be discussed in the following sections. Persistent depressive disorder. Formerly known as dysthymia, persistent depressive disorder has similar, though generally less severe, symptoms as major depression, may include irritability, and affects up to 8% of adolescents. The main difference is it's generally longer lasting, with at least 1 year's duration for adolescents, meaning that even with its milder symptoms, it may be more harmful, affecting children's educational and social learning. Bipolar disorder. In adolescents with bipolar disorder, depressed moods may alternate with manic or irritable highs. In contrast, major depressive disorder is sometimes referred to as unipolar depression. This condition is much less common among both youth and adults than clinical depression, affecting fewer than 3% of U.S. adolescents, yet is also more dangerous and harder to treat. Bipolar disorder is often difficult to recognize early in life, yet the sooner it is identified, treated, and monitored, the better. One major warning sign is if your child goes through periods of appearing to need very little sleep. Adolescents with depression that does not improve over time, with psychotic symptoms such as hallucinations or unrealistic thinking, and with a family history of bipolar disorder, are all at a higher risk for this disorder. Bipolar disorder requires a different treatment than depression, and it will include medications. For more information on bipolar disorder, please see our companion book, If Your Adolescent Has Bipolar Disorder. Disruptive Mood Dysregulation Disorder. Disruptive Mood Dysregulation Disorder, DMDD, describes a child who has an irritable or angry mood most of the day, nearly every day. Symptoms typically begin before age 10 and may include severe and otherwise inexplicable temper tantrums 3 or more times on average per week, together with trouble functioning at home or at school due to the irritable mood. To be diagnosed, a child must be under the age of 18 and have these symptoms steadily for 12 months or longer. DMDD first became a diagnosis in 2013 with the publication of the DSM-5. It arose out of concerns that too many children with this problem were being misdiagnosed with bipolar disorder and possibly given the wrong medications. Today, researchers believe that up to 5% of children and adolescents have this disorder. Yet the diagnosis remains controversial among experts who think normal childhood behavior is being over-medicalized. Some clinicians suggest that the explosive outbursts constitute more of a symptom, like a fever or sore throat, rather than a unique disorder. Still, researchers have found that while children diagnosed with DMDD may resemble children with bipolar disorder, more of them will go on to develop depression and anxiety. Now, let's address some of the known and suspected causes of all these varieties of depressed mood. What are the biological roots of depression? Scientists have found clear evidence linking depression to a variety of physical phenomena, including individual differences in brain development and chemistry. It's worth the effort to familiarize yourself with some of these findings. A basic understanding of the physical aspects of depression can help you appreciate how at least some of your child's behavior is beyond his or her control. It may also make you more comfortable with a doctor's recommendation to use medication to treat a condition that has both medical and psychological components. Once I learned a little bit about what lay behind my daughter's depression, I was more patient with her, says Jean, whose teen was hospitalized after a suicide attempt. I also didn't get so stuck and frustrated when doctors tossed around words like serotonin and cortisol. Doctors may have your best interests at heart and still lapse into jargon or unnecessarily detailed clinical explanations when you are anxiously trying to make sense of a condition that they themselves don't completely understand, or about which the science remains unclear. Nor will many of them be able to give you satisfying answers during a typical office appointment, during which they may be rushed and you may be feeling overwhelmed. You don't need a medical degree, however, to absorb the upcoming summary. If you want to delve deeper, check out the resources section found in the print and ebook versions of this book, where, among other things, we recommend a couple of excellent lay readers' books on the brain. Variations in brain architecture. Researchers have found substantial evidence of measurable differences in the volume, thickness, and surface area of various brain regions of healthy children compared with those suffering from depression. The results of past studies aren't conclusive, however, and scientists today are hunting for clearer answers. Scientists working on several major longitudinal studies have been scanning young subjects' brains to examine the relationship between brain development over time and the expression of psychiatric disorders. While more research is needed, they have found evidence that certain brain structures are smaller in people with depression. Still unknown is whether that difference is causing the problem. In other words, Are young people with smaller brain structures more likely to be depressed? Or has depression somehow already caused that difference? And are these changes permanent or reversible? Note, if a clinician recommends that you have your child's brain scanned to diagnose a mental illness, we advise that you seek a second opinion, as this is not standard practice, may entail considerable expense, and is unlikely to be helpful. The exception to this rule is when neurological symptoms suggest another and possibly related medical illness. Variations in brain chemistry. Another potentially significant difference in the brains of depressed people has to do with chemicals known as neurotransmitters. In healthy brains, these chemical messengers help the cells, called neurons, communicate with each other by ferrying messages across synapses, the gaps between cells. Yet, in the brains of depressed people, something interferes with this process, causing changes in the balance of neurotransmitters that affect the way the neurons function. Until recently, scientists developing antidepressants have focused on serotonin, a neurotransmitter that helps regulate sleep, appetite, anxiety, and sexual drive. But today, they understand that many more neurotransmitters are involved, including norepinephrine, dopamine, GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid, and glutamate. Norepinephrine influences the body's response to stress, and it helps regulate arousal, sleep, and blood pressure. Dopamine is essential for physical movement, while also influencing a person's sense of pleasure, motivation, and perception of reality. GABA plays a role in anxiety, and glutamate is key to overall brain functioning. Today's most popular antidepressant medications work by increasing the brain's supply of some of these neurotransmitters. Again, scientists still need to figure out whether the chemical fluctuations they've found are the cause or effect of depression. Many believe the relationship cuts both ways, with brain chemistry affecting behavior and behavior affecting brain chemistry. For instance, we know that stress can alter brain chemistry, leading to depression. Yet when people effectively manage their stress, they may be able to change their own brain chemistry and improve their moods. Other variations. Still another physical difference in people with depression involves the immune system. Increasing research has suggested that depression may be the result of chronic inflammation. This intriguing finding suggests there may be other important targets for treatment that researchers have yet to discover. Lastly, and also promisingly, researchers are also looking at the guts. There's evidence that irritation in the gastrointestinal system signals the central nervous system in the brain and spinal cord, triggering mood changes. What if a microbiome transplant could help treat depression? Intriguing as this question may be, there is, at this writing, no systematic research to answer it. As diagnostic technology, including brain scans, improves, there's new hope that scientists will soon better understand the causes of depression and other mood disorders, which could lead to many more effective treatments. We'll tell you more about the new research avenues in the conclusion. Does gender matter? Gender is a factor in mood disorders of all kinds. Before puberty, the rates of depression are equal in boys and girls, but afterward, girls are 2 to 3 times as likely to have the disorder. We still have a lot to learn about why this is so, but researchers suspect it's partly due to the influence of hormones, and possibly also because girls are likelier to have suffered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.